Hello, this is Stimming. Welcome to my studio. To get started, I think it's a good idea to just show you where I'm actually working. Just I give you a little overview of what my studio looks like. Okay, so that's my working space. Monitors, key, outboard, piano, C15, some other stuff. Oh, and a little bit like a prison feeling because of the windows. This is what my studio looks like in April 2020, Corona crisis hitting me hard because I got two little children which need to go to the kindergarten, but they can't, and my wife is also working, so I look tired, not because I don't get too much sleep, but because the days are so exhausting. Anyway, I try to give my best to entertain you a little bit, to give you a little bit of insight. You asked so many questions. Thank you a lot. I think it was like more than 100 questions all at all different channels. So, wow, I didn't expect that. I hope I will not disappoint you. So let's get on, and I'm going to answer those questions. I didn't have to think too much about it, even if I had very, very many of those machines. And it's the MFB Tanzbär. So the MFB Tanzbär, and that's my favorite one. You might ask yourself why. Because it sounds so good. Let me show you. And another sound. You hear that? It's like, it's very simple, but round and warm. It's pretty much exactly what my sound philosophy is about. I love it. It's like the only machine where I really like very many sounds out of it. The white noise is beautiful. The bass drum, especially the bass drum 2, because it's the warmer one. The bass drum 1 is not, I think I never used the bass drum 1. The rim shot. So beautiful. It's like a little, I love it. The clap is nice. Let me show you the clap. Do you hear that? And then if you combine this with something real, like this. I love that. I really, really love that. Some other patterns, maybe? Okay, let me show you some other ones. Let me show you some other ones. So it's definitely heritage from you remember those rhythm machines from home organs back in the 70s, and I think this is where MFB originally, I think the first machine MFB built was something like this rhythm section of an home organ, but with rock and roll rhythms. Sounded something like that. Well, that's not a rock and roll one. Richie Horton would have loved that in the 90s. So yeah, it still has this weird plop, plop, clicker, clacker, old school sound next to it, but it can also do some very, very futuristic, fat sounding stuff. So that's my favorite analog drum machine. I think the most useful drum machine out there is the Electron Digitakt, I'm afraid. No, I'm not. No, it's really nice. The Digitakt is really, I would say, the drum machine, because it's a sampler, it's the most versatile one. You can't complain about a Digitakt, I think. There's absolutely nothing. The machine I recently fell in love with is the 1010 Music Black Box, but I use it as a recorder where you can record stuff in a musical context immediately, which is great to like fire some loops next to recording something on top of it. But it's also like a sketchbook. It's the 1010 Music Black Box is the best sketchbook I had for a very, very long time. So if I would be traveling, if I would be making money in for playing live with stuff like these. Yeah, that's an, oh wait, I'm talking about this, yeah. So that's an A350, a beautiful machine. If I would be traveling, I would carry a black box with me instead of a computer. Because I'm playing live without a computer, as you all, as many of you know. So the black box would be the one to make music when I'm sitting in a plane or waiting in hotel, that kind of stuff. But let's see, one day I will be doing this again. I'm still using this, for example, at home. So I have something in the studio that which I bounce or print. I print a wave, put it in the black box. And at home I have some other synths, or I have an idea which I could like bring into reality with my live set, which is at home. And then I just record it in there, and it's the black box writes a wave file on the micro SD card, and I just swap the micro SD card in the computer here and put it back in the studio, and that's very, very convenient. Yeah, it's very convenient. All right, that was question number one. Let's just stay at the gear weirdness talk. No, not weird, but the gear talk. Oh, not to forget, the favorite drum machine. We were talking about the favorite drum machine. So the Tanzbär is my go-to drum machine. If I would need to choose one drum machine for the rest of my life, well, I would choose for a Digitakt, but for an analog, anyway, I got a, Pulsar 23. Is it on? No, it's not on. It's on, but it's not connected right now. It's pretty fresh. I learn it at home right now. So I've read the manual twice already. Oh man, it's difficult. It's a complicated machine, but I got a feeling that this machine, apart from like there's some kind of stuff where hopefully the team from Electronic Beats can visit me in Hamburg, because they're coming from Berlin, and we're doing the next test video with this. Write in the comments if you want them to do that. So it's an incredible machine, and I got a feeling that this machine delivers what we think it will, right? So it's somehow, because it's like it's basically a modular system, it's so open with some downtakes of the openness, like synchronization is a little bit of not that easy as just like switching on MIDI clock. But I got a feeling that this one might be like really a door opener for the future of, for the next generation of drum machines. I got a feeling, but let's see. So as I'm having quite a lot of hardware around me, my favorite digital synth is the C15. Right, let's, I'm gonna put the camera back on. So maybe like this, the light is so difficult. Luckily I got another camera down here, so this is gonna show you what I do. The C15, for all of those who don't know it, it's the, it's from Non-Linear Labs. The owner is Stefan Schmidt. He's one of the guys who invented Native Instruments in the 90s. So a visionary in a sense. And after all those Native Instruments getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and more convenient. And when you go, when you buy the complete, you basically, you better buy a hard drive with those 3 million gigabytes of sounds and presets with it. It's basically, yeah, well, for the working musician who needs to do a soundtrack fast, who's in the post, who needs something, it's convenient and it makes money, which is totally fine. It's not that creative, to be honest. So he recognized that as well. And what he did was he focused on one reactor ensemble. And by the way, someone asked, I forgot his name, someone asked which sound on Quecksilver was the main hook, the main melody on Quecksilver. That's the vocal transformer in Reaktor. It's like, I think it's called Simple Voice or something. And I love it. Unfortunately, I got rid of very many big companies inside the computer, also Native Instruments, so I don't have it right now. I'm using the kit from the one from Kaivo. No, the one from Androna Labs. How are they called? Anyway. Let's get back to the C15. So he focused on one reactor ensemble, and then he built it into a computer. It's like it's an Intel NUC with an i3 in there, passively cooled and operating system around it. And then there's no MIDI on it. So he has an incredible keyboard inside, but he decided, okay, I am guilty of doing harm to music because of Native Instruments. So he never said that, but I feel like that's a little bit of his, I could imagine that would be his thinking. So I'm gonna do something radical. What he did was the C15, where, or maybe maybe I use this camera. Okay, I want to play you something, so I just put it back to get like two hands. You can't go wrong with C minor. Yeah, it's incredible. It's the, like, as well, he forces you to use your hands, which I'm fine with. I come back to that later. So as he says, like, okay, you need your hands, otherwise you're not being able to play that instrument. That's nowadays it's radical, which is weird because, like, humanity always needed its hands or its voice for making music, right? And suddenly the new technology thinks that it's a good idea to use your fucking finger and click what the fuck? Like one finger only from the hand. Okay, I'm sorry for swearing. Or like a little touchpad. Yeah, you see, I'm not the biggest fan of that part of our new technology. The code is incredible, and the new sounds, and especially the speakers, are incredible. So yeah, that's my favorite digital synth. My favorite analog synth is the Swayman S1. Let me show you on this camera. The Swayman S1. Bloop. No. Yeah. Fully analog, 3 oscillator. I think everyone who's into modular systems, knows Swayman. It's like an incredible expensive company. Yeah, I admit those two are very expensive. But probably they are the ones which I gonna have in another 10 years. Or the others, maybe not. But this one. Oh, and the Pulsar I'm gonna keep. And the Tanzbär I'm gonna keep. Also hardware. I also like the Hydra synth. Honestly, I think really it's a really, really nice synthesizer. It inspires me a lot, even if I can mostly use the pads and the space for sounds. For anything else, I think it's still a bit digital. I also ordered the Argon 8 to like compare it with the Hydra synth. The Argon is really good, but in if you compare it to the Hydra synth one by one, the price has a reason. That's everything I'm gonna say about it. Of course, the instruments you choose determine a lot how you're gonna sound in the end. So it's definitely a good idea to consciously pick them. For example, if you buy a Roland JV expander, like one of those expanders who has 3,000 sounds, you're gonna sound like the music which is played before the news in the television, or if you like imagine a very cheap commercial music, then those are the sound machines you're gonna need then. Sorry. So yeah, there's something weird about synths that sometimes if you like buy simpler ones, it's more creative what you do with it. And unfortunately, the price, even when there's a company who tries people to believe that the price people want to believe that the price isn't that important anymore, it still is. So yes, the Swayman, when I bought it, it cost me 3,600 euros and I needed to wait like half a year for it. I didn't regret 1 euro. And mostly because I can use a very simple sound. I have a problem with, in the mid-range, with analog sounds, like analog, like just a saw wave and then a little bit filtered. Somehow my ears hate this in the mid-range, but for the bass, it's incredible. You need an analog synth for bass. Yeah. So basically I'm using the resonance from the filter here, because it's the most powerful sinus wave out there for my taste. So yes, I consciously pick what I use. And inside the computer, I really look for the... I don't need a Serum. The Quantas. No, wait, which one? The Cypher is quite nice inside the computer, but I'm really mostly into the Chromaphone, the String Studio from AAS, both. The Pigments is also quite nice, I have to say. I'm a big fan of the Quanta, the granular synth from, who was it? Audio Damage. So I consciously pick the pieces, the gear I use, but mostly because of trial and error, and I don't know beforehand how it's gonna come out, to be honest. Very often I buy something and I'm like, yeah, this is gonna be the one. And then I'm like, no, no, it's not. Hmm. All right, let's get back to what I already have. So it's really a round robin. Is that the right word? But there are certain pieces that still, that always stay. So if you like hear the noise from the studio, that's the Bricasti M7 reverb, a very expensive reverb. But as much as I hate it for being noisy as shit, the sound is so good, and there's no plugin, no nothing coming against it when it comes to rooms, when it comes to like psychological, like, how do you say? Like things which you don't recognize, obviously, but if you switch them off, you're suddenly like, something's missing. So for this, the Bricasti is incredible, but it's noisy. So I put it back there, but still, like, my recorder is like... Okay. Yes, I own that one. Because I never had a string machine, and I always wanted to have one, simply because the ability, the chorus sounds nice, and the ability to play very very many tones at once, it's something which I thought I need, but it's on my list to go. Behringer in general, I mean, they're building synths, which a couple of are quite nice, no doubt about it. They make a good example of what you can achieve if you scale up in terms of what quality you can deliver for a certain price. If you scale it up and always think about, okay, we need to sell, they need to sell like 10 or 15,000 at least to get into the green zone and to make some money, to make this the... So I'm fine with that, and I don't want to judge. If I would be a starter again, I would be happy that Behringer exists, because I would be able to buy a proper sounding analog synth. Still, don't believe a Hyundai does what a Porsche does, right? You can get from A to B, but how you get there is, there's a difference. That's one part, and another part is, nothing against Hyundai, by the way. I personally drive a Toyota. Nothing against that. Apart from that, the Peter Kern action, what they did was pretty much the cork sniffer action, was the dumbest thing I ever experienced from a company in our area at all. Like, it was so stupid, it screams like, what the... So I just wanted to remember you, like, obviously some PR guys went crazy, they took too much of whatever. This cork sniffer action was the stupidest, the dumbest thing I've seen. Apart from that, of course, buy a Behringer. No worries. And then even the pedal was a clone. Like, of course, oh yeah, and of course they can be that cheap because they don't have to do groundbreaking stuff in the research and development area, right? So it's not for them, that doesn't take too much money for them. Of course they need to rebuild the circuit and stuff, but the R&D department necessarily isn't that money consuming like other companies do. Just keep that in mind. I mean, it's fine and it's legal, so nothing against that. So there's a certain frequency range which we can use, right? The finished picture will have mostly all frequencies at a certain time in that picture. That means the most necessary thing to do beforehand, before you need to actually, anytime you compress, anytime you EQ, you're fixing something which went wrong in the first place. So To avoid that, it's very clever to throw in stuff into your track which hopefully not interfere with each other. So for example, if I have a chord here, and if I use another synth to put that on top of it, you will get a problem simply because some frequencies will add up and then your master out will explode, the level's gonna explode. So instead of using this frequency, if you could add something down here and up here, what I'm saying, when the finished picture isn't clear, I try to use slices that don't interfere too much. Then there's a problem. Once you throw them in, you don't necessarily hear if they interfere, if they are making problems. So you can choose them carefully and stuff, but if you have an issue somewhere, you usually don't, it's very difficult to hear. Because somehow, I don't know, maybe it's a psychological thing or maybe it's the way our internal algorithm in our brain works. So we don't, from my experience, I don't hear it clearly if something interferes given a certain quality in general. So to find that out, it really, the only thing that really actually matters is the... master out. The master. That's the one. This level is what shall guide you. So here you see I got an over of 1.7. I got a problem somewhere. Let me find out where the problem is. So let me start bass drum snare. It could be very easily just the bass drum snare problem. Yeah, so the bass drum itself is 2.4. Oh, let me just quickly get rid of the... Okay, the bass drum is 2.4. The snare is minus 12. So both of them add up to minus 0.4. Minus 0.4 means you don't have any space left, basically. Hello, camera. You don't have any space left. So it would be clever to remix, to do something already here, because it's too close. It's making problems. I don't know, maybe... I hear this snare has already quite a bit of low end, which I'm not sure if it really needs it. Okay, let's try that. I just cut a bit of low end. And we gain... So this little trick already... Voila. This little trick already gained us, it wasn't even a trick, like it's 0.6, so right now we're at minus 1 at master. Much more space left, because the main issue with the bass drum and the bass, like the very low frequencies, is that they have incredible high amount of energy. So there were very many people asking me how I get the low end right. I mostly get it right because I'm aware of the importance in the mixing area. So everything has to sit in its place and nothing should interfere in the very beginning of a track, in any sound you put in. That's the key to sounding transparent. For me, I don't like saturation in the low end too much. So what I try to do is to keep the sounds as clear as possible, not fiddling around with frequencies too much. So if I have a good sounding bass drum, for example, yeah, so this bass drum is too deep for your normal computer speakers. You need headphones for that. It's pretty much of a bass drum, and I don't touch it too much anymore. Like, it's fine. Maybe I would, what would I do? I would put a little bit of low end, something like 50 hertz plus 2, maybe shorten it a tiny bit. I like it. The trick is to mix it right. If I have a proper bass drum, I take care that I leave it where it is and don't have to touch it too much afterwards. If I would add up a bass here, I would take care not to use the same frequency. I very often use percussive basses, which means it's easier to place it in between the bass drum. Actually, that's the trick. If you like put a bass right on top of the bass drum, no chance. You will never get to mix it. If you would use a sound which is on top of the bass drum, either the volume has to be very low or the frequency has to be much higher. And then it might be clever not to use the octave up, but to use something in between so the frequencies don't add up too easily. For example, you might be able to do that, but then it's a matter of the master out on your mix, on the master out. That's the one that's going to show you if it fits or not. My secret for a good bass drum bassline combination, and then keeping it juicy and powerful. Juicy for me means keeping the sounds clear. That means no saturation, no distortion on bass drum bassline. Then frequency separation is very important. Yes, of course, I very often do sidechain compression. Maybe I can show it right now. I should have done that one instead of... No, but right here, right now, was Fatboy Slim, right? Not Moby. But because that's my remix for Moby, Natural Blue. Okay. I'm going to show you on Bitwig what I do very often. Let's hope the camera will not, it's going to make you seasick. Okay, this one has an output of minus 12. Altogether, we go to minus 0.8. You already see this added tom-toms only add up minus 0.2 dB. If I would switch them off, we go to the minus 1. But to do it even further, like to reduce it even more, I do a sidechain compression, but I don't sidechain compress. I just use the tool in Bitwig, which is basically controlling amplitude, panning, or width. I can swap left and right and change phase. Sorry. So then in Bitwig you can insert modulators into any plugin, like literally any plugin. Even if the tool comes from Bitwig, you can do it on any plugin, and those modulators For example, an ADSR envelope, audio rate, audio sidechain, a math module, MIDI input, a note counter, an XY pad, a sample and hold generator, a step sequencer, a key tracker, whatever. I use the audio sidechain and get the audio from the bass drum. As simple as this. It actually, the fun begins if you do something more complicated. Anyway, so what I do, I press that button. Da-da-da, I gained minus 0.2. That was a very basic, something very basic to do, but that's basic, but that's the work. That's mixing. You use a tool, any type of tool. If you're EQing, you use the EQ for reducing frequencies more than for adding up frequencies. And anything you do, you check your master out, because that's the truth. The truth is in the master out. Oh, and good speakers show you if it's good. They're not necessarily show you mixing issues, not as clear as the master out from my experience, but since the ATC SEM25, since then, my speaker history started at the point where a speaker was able to show me when the mix was right. So I was like, suddenly, from then on any track I did, there's a point where I feel like, now it's good. And then I look on the master out and there's no over. That means it's good. Okay, let me just quickly switch on the power again. Okay. So, bass drum, bass line. Yes, you can sidechain it. I don't tune the bass drum. I don't, of course I tune it, but I don't use the bass drum necessarily in tune to the key of the track, the tone height. I don't do this because for me it sounds quite boring. I detune it always a bit. I wouldn't be surprised if it makes mixing a bit easier, but I'm not sure. I'm swallowing air while talking. Wow. Is that normal? Am I normal? Okay. So that was the bass drum. So the main mixing thing, again, I just need to say it again. Mixing and creating a track and not doing and not causing issues right from the beginning, which are more and more complicated to fix afterwards. So a good example is if you're already in the middle of the track process and then removing the bass drum and using another one. It's pretty much impossible. It's a good idea not to try it. Like, do the right decision right from the beginning, because otherwise that's not gonna fit. The frequency spectrum is the whole picture, and you have to find slices that fit into each other right from the beginning. This will help you in the mixing process later on. And I do mixing right from the beginning, just to, like, it's part of the process. It's like the creation process. I mix it all together. Writing, mixing, going crazy, looping, all this is one for me. And at the end, I feel like, okay, I got it. And then I decide to finish. I mix while producing, and no, I have nothing on the masterbus, because, as I said earlier, the masterbus is the truth. That's a fact. And to all the American friends, there is something like the truth, at least in audio production. And this is the master out level. If you put a limiter on there, of course you could switch the limiter on and look how much it's gonna do, but it will make things more complicated. What you can do is, once the track is nearly finished, you can put a limiter in there, you can switch on a limiter, and just to see how the mix reacts if you push it like 3 or from 3 to 6 dB inside the limiter, because that's what's going to happen in the mastering. That's a good idea to just check, to just see how it's going to react, because then you might also hear difficulties. There was a time though where I had the API 2500 on my master out just a tiny little bit to glue it all together. But it's a matter of taste, right? It's always a matter of taste. The master out is the truth, but what you do beforehand is a matter of taste. I even would go that far. If we would be able to do like a perfect mix, you wouldn't need mastering. And if the speakers would be perfect, like a theoretical idea of a perfect speaker, you wouldn't need mastering as well. Because it's a little bit of, glutamate, the taste, the umami powder you put into food. That's what mastering does. It puts umami in it. If the food itself has enough umami, for example, sushi or parmesan or tomatoes, they bring it naturally with them. You don't need to put powder on top of it, even if mastering engineers have very expensive powder. Not only mastering engineers, there is club owners who have expensive. Anyway, so there's nothing on my masterbus while producing. That's a swing, which on an electron machine is somewhere between 55% and 61%. On the Tanzbär, which has a swing from 1 to 8, it's 3 or 4. On Bitwig, I think it's so groovy because I don't quantize too much. I quantize certain things. Of course, the bass drum, the main hi-hat is quantized. But if you add up a shaker next to the quantized hi-hat, you're on the winner's side. I play one. So that's a groove. So this here, I would look on which sample position this kind of groove is, and if I program a synth on underneath it, for example the bass line or a chord or something, I would take care that it's exactly the same position, right? So the loop here would be half of a bar, and there would be one certain sample position number, and I would take care that any important part which is there would be on that position. This would groove like hell, I think. Another one. Let me look for another sample, for another shaker. Nuts. Now I'm going nuts. Another one. From here, I would record like half a minute, and then there will be one little loop, which is exactly what I want, and I would use that loop and only that one. I don't have the, how do you say, the will of an instrumentalist to find something and then play it for 3 minutes throughout the whole track as a one take, because then only then I'm a good musician. I don't have that. I don't think I really need that. Thanks to computers, I don't need that. Yeah. So, and in general, the shakers are what make a groove. And they can be very soft, just in the background. Our ear will get to know them. And a function one horn tweeter is gonna punch it in you anyway. In your eardrums, I mean. Another question which came up very often was the question of my speakers. As you see, I got the key 3. And the key 3. Why I ditched the ATC monitors instead of the key 3. So, a couple of years ago, not too long ago, something has happened in the speaker market for, let's say, compact sized speakers, which was DSP and Class D amps. It's basically like Class D, that was a bit longer ago, allowed speaker manufacturers or amp manufacturers to build like very small, very efficient amps, which don't produce too much heat and which only use power when they're actually like amping something, because a Class A is powering all the time and a Class D only when you really need it. I think it's not so, yeah. And yeah, so the ATCs are, let's say, like a Rolls Royce, a very old school type of speaker, a very, very luxury one, incredibly sounding with problems. Like cars have the problems of burning fuel. Old school speakers, or like traditional type of speakers, have the problem of don't being neutral. I wouldn't say at all, but not necessarily being neutral. And neutral, just as a word for, how do I say? So I switched to the key 3 because they're freaking much better than the ATCs. The ATCs were really, really good. I love listening to speakers in general. And since I use in-ear monitors on stage, I realized what, and like getting to know their capabilities of showing the whole frequency spectrum, especially when it's a one driver concept, without any phase issues. So you have 3 drivers in a speaker. That means you have 2 frequency filtering in there, and this filter always like switch does phase issues. So in a traditional speaker, something, a correct signal comes into the speaker, and then it's going to divide it into, let's say, 2 ways, and in between the 2 ways there's phase problems. So the key has a controlling system where, or let's say the key has a system of knowing how the speaker membranes, where they are, how they work. Any of those 6 membranes, 2 in the front, 2 at the side, and 2 at the back, any of this membrane has a 250 watts Class D amp, which means there's a freaking lot of power, which is not made for being as loud as possible, but used for being as precise as possible. So the speaker, what it does is, let me show you here, at pretty much this point, like 5 centimeters in front of the tweeter in the middle speaker, it builds a phase correct point source. And there's a DSP controlling and filtering everything on with linear filters. That's why it has a latency, unfortunately. It has a latency of 80 milliseconds, which for the mixing process is okay, but for recording something, it's definitely not okay. So that's why there's a low latency mode. Anyway, the DSP controls the membranes in a way that 5 centimeters in front of the speaker is a phase correct signal. It gets its signal through a digital, in this case an AES input, but it could also be an optical input or the USB. It can work as a USB audio interface. One speaker gets the signal and sends it to the next speaker via a network cable. It's pretty much a computer which controls the speaker, and it sounds incredibly correct. Yeah, to give you an idea, the frequency range is from 30 Hz to 20 kHz, plus minus 0.5 dB. Yeah, and I think the ATC SCM50 does 55 Hz to 20 plus minus 3 dB. So it's like a much more complex, much more sound what the speaker does to the signal, which is fine. And some do get it very, very good. So yes, when it comes to speakers, I'm a bit of a perfectionist. Maybe not a bit, I'm a freaking perfectionist. The problem with the frequency range from the keys, 30 Hz up to 20 kHz plus minus 0.5 dB, means there's a very, very big amount of bass that's coming out from those. Oh, by the way, they have a kidney. What's the one? It's not omnidirectional, like a normal speaker. They have like a microphone. They only go to the front with the bass. The two speakers at the back are made for eliminating the bass at the back. So usually it's not, they are easier for the room, but because of they're going so deep, you got new issues, which are gonna, and that's, those are the two black ones. I'm gonna show it on the other camera. That's why I needed to buy this Avas from C Audio, which are active bass traps. They listen to the bass and they reduce it just where the biggest pressure happens. So they soak it and they pretend to widen the room for I think the volume of the trap 20 times. Yes, I hear the difference. Okay, so that's why. There's also the Key 3 is one of those next level speakers. The other one is Dutch & Dutch H8C. Those two are competing. I think the Dutch & Dutch is not as digital, so people saying they sound a bit more analog. The Key 3 is just, I wouldn't say it sounds at all. It's just what you send in comes out. Okay. Yes, I'm very happy with them, of course. They cost 10,000 euros, which is a freaking lot, but the ATCs did cost that as well. I don't have, like sometimes when I have something and it doesn't satisfy me totally, I have this itchy fingers, but here I don't have it at all. The only question was if I want to add like gain, a little bit of gain, of power, of loudness. I would need the bass expansion, which is very expensive, and maybe it would be too much. So I'm good with that. And then I do listen on three different systems. I listen on the Key 3. I listen on this Sony headphone. Let's see if my Sony camera is focusing right. The Sony MDR7506, 100 euro headphone, a very narrow mid and very wide stereo sound, but nothing in between. So it's kind of a it's not the best headphone, but I'm so used to it, and it's crazy. I don't find another headphone. I somehow hate how they sound. There's any headphone I heard has an issue. Any. So this is the one where I'm familiar with the issues, and I like how it sounds in general. I like the picture, what it translates, the picture that it shows. This is the one. And I also work with in-ears. So I work on stage with in-ears. I work in the studio with in-ears. I got different types. The ones I like most right now are the Sennheisers IE400. I haven't checked the 500. I think they're even a bit better because the 400 has a problem in the 6 kilohertz range. Yeah, and now the speaker technology seems to get better and better. I'm talking about PA systems. They get better because speaker? Huh? Void. Martin Audio. I love the Martin Audio. No, wait. No. D&B. The D&B is the one. D&B Audio Technique. That's my favorite company. I would say PAs still become better and better because they are capable of reproducing sound in a very, very high loudness without distortion, which is good for the ears, which is good for our minds. And then, just as I raved about the Key 3 earlier, it seems that the combination of DSP controlled and clever design, basically, but like a design which includes all the new developments, really puts us steps forward. And I'm talking about neutrality in a positive sense, not in a boring way. Speakers. Yes, touch screens is something which I really like. Even if it's far away from perfect. So I just can say it again, like we have incredibly beautiful tools which are called our hands. They are one of the most well-designed tools there are on this world. The most, how do you say, versatile. The most versatile tools there are at this world, at the whole world. And we humans decided with new technology to use a mouse or a touchpad, a tiny touchpad. We can do swipe with three fingers, which is better than one finger and click and like get problems in your ankles, which every mouse user knows that there are problems. So I'm using a touchscreen, and let me show you a bit how I do that. So again, this is Bitwig, and the touchscreen allows me to pretty easily navigate in the arrangement. Also, if I would like to work on that snare, I could go in here. Yeah, it's not easy to switch off the grid or not. I would need the other hand for the shift key. Well, this all makes a lot of sense. So, to be honest, it's not as fast as a mouse. But somehow, I'm using my hand more than using a mouse. Here in the play area from Bitwig, I told you about the modulators. One of those modulators in Bitwig is the Expressions tab. And I already routed the timbre to the cutoff. So here, someone say a cat is crying. Yeah, this is pretty cool. It's a bit more vital. I'm still not a fan of like touching a glass surface. That's actually the reason why I'm still using this Wacom tablet, because the surface area feels a bit like paper, feels better than polished glass, which we have on our smartphones, or if I would buy, I checked a couple of touch screens. So this Wacom tablet screen, it's just a screen with the pen and touch technology, is connected to a PC, just a Windows PC. I'm a Windows guy. So it's a bit like real progression has to use what's already there and then go a step forward. And I would say yes, a DAW with a touch interface is something like that. It really is a step forward. It's even a bigger step than you might initially think of, because it's a more natural and not as angry input. Angry in a sense like humanity using its hands for so many beautiful things. And now we have a tool which is called CPU and algorithms that are tools for like also very beautiful things, but the input is just the mouse. I don't get it. I don't get the... A keyboard is something else. On a keyboard it's like... But a mouse... Yeah. Overbridge isn't very nice technology. Electrons overbridge getting rid, like sneaking around the main driver and putting and bringing an audio stream inside a plugin. It's freaking awesome, I must say. And in Bitwig it works. So yeah, that's quite cool. That's very convenient. Also portable recorders and their quality is also very, very nice, especially the 32-bit portable. Unfortunately I don't have one, but imagine, I think the dynamic range on a 32-bit recording is more than 1000 dB. So basically it doesn't matter how you dial in, or you, there's no over again. You will not be able to clip a recording, which is I think a very, very big step in audio. It's coming digital with 32-bit float. It's audio is coming closer to digital, audio is coming closer to analog. So I'm looking forward to this technology getting more and more into our audio interfaces. A PC or a Mac is a very powerful platform for all kinds of programs, which basically are tools, right? It's tools. It's like a hammer, but sometimes a very complex one, sometimes a very simple one. The issue with the platform is it is made for being able to run any type of program, whereas a specialized platform, for example, an Electron machine, or I was talking about the Black Box from 1010 Music earlier, uses a chip which is optimized only for one certain task. So it becomes a special tool again, but it's gonna do what it's supposed to do better than a universal platform, mostly because of stability, but also the Black Box, too bad I don't have it with me here. The Black Box has like four knobs, two and two placed around the touchscreen. And the touchscreen is a very good one. So it reacts very, very precisely, but there are certain things that work better with a knob or with a potentiometer than on a touchscreen. So the combination, the user interface, or the possibility of building a user interface which fits perfectly to the task you wanted to achieve, that's a big difference. And I think that's going to be more important, more and more, that we get back to kind of specialized tools, while the technology, the digital technology, well, I think, yeah, I think that's something I'm raving about, like specialized tools, but digital ones, because of the user interface and because of the stability. I actually remember exactly when and where it was, because it hit me like a flash. And I was 6:15, close to become 16. So I was still a boy, so I'm one of the humans who are lucky to know what they want to do quite early. I know that is an issue for very many people. It wasn't for me, but I have to say I always wanted to do something with music, so it was pretty clear, like music was there every time. I played the drums, I played the piano, my parents put me into piano lessons. Unfortunately, I never had a good piano teacher who told me about harmonics. He just wanted me to learn, like to practice, but I never practiced, neither the drums. So, when was it? I was 15 and I was hanging around with the best friend I had at that time, and we were listening to music. And what we did, we, in the dangerous age of, how do you say, halbstarken, not being adult, but somewhere in between, fully in our pubertät, what's the name? Papu. Anyway, you know what I mean. 16-year-old boys want to make bullshit. So we smoked a bit of weed and we listened. So that was the opposite of bullshit, actually. Maybe the weed, you know, the dosage makes the poison. And take care not to smoke too much. But we did it back then, and it was very innocent, just like half of a spliff, like puffing a couple of times, and then listening to an album for an hour. And then we were like, oh, I'll listen to that sound. And as I was doing music anyway, in one of those tracks, actually, I know it was the Space Knight volume 8 or 9, it hit me, and I was like, okay, that's what I want to do. The next day, I was throwing on the Magic's Music Maker, recording some Takuya Ishino. I think I was already getting in contact with new kind of electronic music, which back in, that was, I'm 36 now, that was 20 years ago, and we didn't have online Spotify, whatever. We needed to go to record shops and kind of sneak against, get behind the guy at the counter or make him bring me good music. And they, most of them were very arrogant. So, it hit me like a flash when I was 16. It was Space Knight, which was a very good compilation back then, where from the Bavarian television, where they combined video from shot from NASA, so from the space, all kinds of stuff, like the Earth, the ISS. Was the ISS up already? I don't know. Yeah. And from then on, I just worked on that. And it really got better when I decided, okay, I'm not forcing myself to do a lot every day, but to do something, even if it's just a tiny bit, but every day. That was one of the key areas, I think, one of the key points for me to really proceed in what I'm doing.